If I asked you where gasoline comes from, it's dinosaurs, right? Fossil fuels dug out of the ground. But it doesn't have to be. See, it's possible to make gasoline synthetically using this, this, and a little bit of energy. You're gonna have to trust me here.
They're known as eFuels, and the people who make them believe that they could provide a carbon neutral way to power combustion engines without having to dig up oil, giving a second clean life to gas guzzling cars, planes and trains.
But are eFuels really carbon neutral, and will we be using them to cleanly power our cars in the future? Let's find out. So the gas that I've just put in my car is made of hydrocarbons, hydrogen and carbon, two elements that are pretty much everywhere.
Carbon is in the CO2 that I'm breathing out, and hydrogen is in H2O, water.
But how on earth do you turn air and water into gasoline?
To answer that, I've come to synthetic fuel startup Zero. Here, the company is building a small development line where they say they'll be making 20 litres, which is around 5 gallons, of synthetic fuel a day for testing and certification. Their CEO is this man, Paddy Lowe, who you may recognise from his many years as technical director for a string of Formula One teams.
When we burn a hydrocarbon, we produce carbon dioxide and water, and all we do in our chemistry is put those back together again.
Sounds simple, right? Well, it's not. First, you need to extract hydrogen from water. Here's Zero's director, Professor Nilay Shah.
The water is electrolyzed, where you put the water into a unit and you combine that with an electric current, and it splits the water back into hydrogen and oxygen.
You then need to isolate CO2 from the air using a carbon capture unit, like this one at Imperial College where Professor Shah teaches.
So now we have carbon dioxide and hydrogen, and those form the starting materials for the next part of our process.
Now, Zero told me this part is somewhat proprietary, but essentially the CO2 and hydrogen are converted using pressure and heat into H2O and hydrocarbons, which you can then turn into jet fuel, diesel, and good old-fashioned gasoline.
There is no limit because there's no digging anything under the ground. Everything comes literally from the atmosphere and goes back there when you're finished with it.
And while that may have been a very simplified explanation of a very complex scientific process, it's not exactly a new principle.
After all, during World War II, the vast bulk of Germany's aviation fuel and half of its gasoline came from synthetic fuel manufacturing. So if it's possible, and has been for quite some time, why aren't e-fuels everywhere?
Well, firstly, there's the energy required to make them.
Every step of manufacturing synthetic fuels can be quite energy intensive, and you get a lot less energy out than you put in.
Our target is for about half the energy that you put in as electricity to end up as the fuel.
That's led some to question why you would use the fuel for cars when batteries can be more efficient.
Then there's the carbon neutrality. For e-fuels to be truly carbon neutral, their creation has to be powered by sustainable, renewable sources like solar and wind.
And then there's the tailpipe.
Environmental groups point out that while synthetic fuels can create less emissions than fossil fuels, they still create more tailpipe emissions than an EV, which doesn't have a tailpipe at all. Finally, there's cost. Right now, this whole process isn't cheap.
To put it into perspective, Zero's limited edition first batch of its fuel, which is more of a souvenir than anything else, runs at just over $200 a gallon, though Paddy assures me those prices will come down.
We anticipate that we will be making synthetic fuel at cost parity with fossil fuels within a decade.
So will we be driving synthetic gas guzzlers in the future? Well, it depends who you ask.
See, in the EU, they've granted an exemption for e-fuels in the bloc's 2035 ban on sales of new internal combustion engines, which basically means that automakers can continue to sell gas cars, providing they only run on e-fuels.
WSJ reporter Bill Boston covers autos and lives in Berlin.
There are going to be millions of cars on the road for many years to come that have combustion engines. They believe that e-fuels is a way to keep those cars on the road and also lower emissions at the same time.
However, when it comes to investing in e-fuels,
if you follow the money, the amount of investment going into it does not compare in any way what the industry has already invested in the last 10 years to develop electric vehicles.
So why did the EU throw its weight behind e-fuels?
Well, the reason could have a lot less to do with the environment and a lot more to do with the fact that Germany's main export is cars.
There are so many jobs that depend on making engines. Here in Germany, of the around 800,000 jobs directly related to auto manufacturing, 447,000 of those jobs are linked specifically to the internal combustion engine.
So what does the future hold for e-fuels? Well, while it's likely you'll see them powering planes and trains in the years to come, their high cost means that it's unlikely you'll see them powering the average family car for quite some time.